Thanks for tuning in. The local share market is going to kick off with a loss of a little under 2/3%, according to where the SPY futures came to rest in after hours trade. So that was essentially a reflection of what we saw where US trade is concerned, because in contrast, what we saw where Europe was concerned was actually a more positive picture. But nonetheless, let's unpack what happened on Wall Street last night. If you just want the top line, what it boiled down to was we essentially saw better economic news that put upward pressure on interest rates, and that created headwinds for stocks. So the slightly broader narrative is that we have seen US equity markets now fall for five consecutive sessions when it comes to the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ. That's the longest losing streak that we have seen where since October time of last year. And you know, if you stand back, look at a chart of those markets over the course of this year, you know, the early part of the year was characterized by big moves higher in terms of the licks taken for share markets from time to time. You'd see a little bit of consolidation and another move higher. Now what you're tending to see is that the highs are lower, and that just highlights that under these circumstances you're seeing sellers take advantage of strength, and that has resulted in the S&P 500, for example, losing around 5% since the start of the month. So that's a pretty solid loss. It's just a question of whether or not that is enough for the time being. But if you continue to see those interest rates march higher the way they have been, obviously that becomes a little more fraught. So the reason that the futures, or the big pardon, the interest rate markets moved higher to the extent that they did was that we saw a survey called the Philadelphia Federal Reserve Survey of Manufacturing come in much stronger than what the market had looked at. So look, this used to be, again, a very important survey because it captures a jurisdiction in the US where there used to be a lot of manufacturing activity. It used to be a bellwether. You know, places like Allentown, Bethlehem Steel, you know, these were important names in the history of the industrial story where the United States is concerned. Anyway, that's a sidebar. The bottom line is that this survey had its biggest expansion in 2 years as far as the last month is concerned. The index went from 3.2 to 15.5. So that 12-point increase was much bigger than expected. Within it, there were some other issues as well in terms of the price pressures in the manufacturing piece. And that was enough to push those interest rates higher, as I said. So a two-year government bond, it was up by 5 basis points. So it came in just under 5%, that line in the sand that we've spoken about before, 4.98. And a 10-year government bond up by 5 basis points as well to 4.63%. Yeah. A 5-point move in bonds under these circumstances is pretty small, but it's the trend that is so much capturing the attention of people. Another index that I should point out as well, which highlights the way that markets are responding to the higher interest rate story, is the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index. So this is a measure of the way 30 of the largest technology stocks in the United States that relate to the design, distribution, sales, manufacturer of computer chips a concern. So you've seen that index pull off quite aggressively over the course of recent times. There are only two stocks in that index that finished higher last night. So that was Nvidia, which was up by 0.75%, and Advanced Micro Devices, whose shares were up by around 0.75%. So elsewhere, as far as company news was concerned, Tesla shares were down by around 3% on the back of a broker downgrade. So that stock is one of the worst performers in the S&P 500. It's down by around 40% in year-to-date terms. United Airlines, we spoke about them yesterday in terms of having delivered a much better than expected profit result, and the stock rose 17% yesterday and added another 5% today. So just gives you a sense of how the market, if it's not expecting an outcome, prices will move aggressively one way or the other. In that respect, Netflix reported its earnings after the market closed. So when you look at the performance of the last quarter, there were any number of statistics that you could have looked at that would have been extremely impressive. One of them that stood out was the fact that the number of subscribers that they had added to their books in the first quarter of the year was almost double what the market had anticipated. That figure came in at 9.3 million customers. So the market was looking at closer to something along the lines of 4.8 million. So a staggering improvement beyond expectations in that regard. You know, your conventional measures, earnings per share came in at 5.28. The market was looking for 4.52. Elsewhere, we saw figures relating to that was the best start to a year that they have seen in about 4 years. The problem for them came in the form of their outlook for revenue in the next quarter. That came in at around 9.49 billion. That was the company forecast, and that was just below what the markets had put in. And that was one of the reasons why the stock is down by the better part of 5% in after hours trade. So the way you would rationalize that is that the stock's done very well over the course of this year so far. It's up by about 30% in year to date terms. So a little bit of a moderation following the earnings number, but still in broad terms, the momentum that is being created in their business is quite impressive at the moment. So elsewhere, as far as European markets are concerned, let's talk about them briefly, because the difference being is that you're talking about a jurisdiction where they are anticipating firmly rate cuts, and there are a number of European Central Bank officials that buttressed what the head of the European Central Bank has said in recent days. Christine Lagarde talking about the prospect of a rate cut in June, reiterated by a number of voices last night, combined with the fact that there were better earnings in across the board. So you had the UK market up 0.4%, the French market up by a half, German DAX up 0.4%, the Stock 600 index was up by a quarter of a percent as well. And to the point about lower interest rates, real estate sensitive stocks or real estate or interest rate sensitive stocks tended to be the most improved, but the tech sector in Europe caught a bit of a chill because of what they were seeing going on as far as the other side of the Atlantic is concerned. 10-year government bonds in Germany up 3 basis points to about 2.5%. So as far as the local picture is concerned today, we've got quarterly production reports from Woodside, Whitehaven Coal and Pilbara Minerals. Pilbara's just reported their quarterly numbers. Their production came in at 179,000 tons, so that was just above the 177 tons that the market had anticipated. Sales were a bit shy of what the market was looking for. They came in at around 165,000 tons, so that's up by about 3.3% and short of the 180,000 tons that the market had been looking for. Average realized prices were probably a little bit short of what the market had been looking for as well, coming in at $804 per tonne. So that's compared to $890 per tonne, which was anticipated by the market. So a bit of a mixed bag. Costs were up by more than 5.5% as well. So it remains to be seen how that will be taken on board by investors, depending on the mood. Generally, there is a little bit of hit and a little bit of miss within those figures. So elsewhere, those other quarterly reports will be digested as well. You've seen the US dollar index improve by about 0.5% overnight. So the Aussie dollar is still holding its ground at around 64.2 US cents. All prices not vastly changed overnight, a little bit weaker, if anything, but still hovering at a 3-week low, notwithstanding all the problems that are going on in the Middle East at the moment. I hope you have a safe and restful weekend. I look forward to talking to you again on Monday.